Good morning, PGCC, and welcome to Resurrection Sunday. He lives. Brothers and sisters, can we get a hand clap and praise the fact that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, has risen from the dead. Amen? Amen. If you're joining us online, welcome into the house of the Lord. Family, I'm not going to stand here and pretend that we're not in pain right now, that we're not hurting for the loss of the shepherd of this flock. But as our pastor told us, when people make their transition, we grieve not for the person who transitioned, for ourselves, because we're going to miss them and we're not going to see them again, at least not in this life. Everyone in here, on the sound of my voice, has a Pastor Harding story and a memory. I see you smiling because I have plenty. But we take that memory and we put it right here, and he'll never be that far away from us. Amen? Amen. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." That right there tells us where he resides. Because nobody loved the Lord like the Reverend Dr. Edward P. Harding Jr. No one. Helen Keller, the famous author, political activist, who was blind and deaf, once wrote, "Death is a mere passing from one room into the next. But when I pass into that next room, now I can see, now I can hear." And we know that as our pastor has passed from this room into the next room, his body is whole, his mind is clear, and his spirit is free. And we thank God for that, that he lent him to us for 25 years longer than he should have. Amen. And we thank God for that. God put something on my heart a couple of days ago when I wrote it down, and I didn't know what I was going to say about it, but I know I was going to say it. In Psalms 30, verse 5, it says, "Weeping shall endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning." So ever how long that weeping lasts, because we're going to weep, whether it lasts a day, whether it lasts a week or a month, we will weep. But rest assured that joy will cometh in the morning. And you know why? Because this is the day the Lord has made, and we're going to rejoice and we're going to celebrate the life of our beloved Pastor Harding. And we're going to celebrate that Jesus has risen from the grave. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the ability to come into the house of the Lord one more time to praise your holy name, Lord. We ask that you steal our focus to what you have for us today. Steal our focus to the teachings that you will give us today. Steal our focus to the people and the ministries that will bring to us today through words, through song, through dance, that we will learn what you have for us today, Lord. And we bless you and we thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our hymn of the morning is an old favorite, and it's a song that we can hang our hope on as Christians. "I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, and I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, I know he's near. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today." Let's ring this song out this morning. I serve a Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within.
Amen. The presence of the Lord takes. presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord is here.
The presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord is here.
Come on, put those hands together. If you know that the presence of the Lord is here, the power of the Lord is here, the Spirit of the Lord is here. Amen. The power of the Lord is here. Can we get one more hand clap of praise for our praise team?
and the Catherine Smith Contemporary Dance Ensemble. Amen. Amen. By way of announcements this morning, as we know, on March 24th, our beloved Pastor Harding made his transition. Arrangements have been made to share the sorrow and celebrate his life. And they are as follows. Thursday from 6 to 8 here at PGCC will be a viewing. There will be no Bible study on this Thursday. On Friday, April 5th at 9:30 a.m., there'll be the viewing and the service at the First Baptist Church of Glen Arden, which is 3600 Bright Seat Road, the ministry center there. The family is requested that all members of PGCC please be present for the police escort processional departing from PGCC at 8:30 a.m. On Saturday, April 6th at 10 a.m., there will be a viewing service and his burial at the Roanoke Salem Baptist Church in Garysburg, North Carolina. Our church website, pgcchurch.us, we have provided links to the funeral home's websites where you can donate flowers, send condolences, and access more details of the arrangements. Amen? Amen. So it is time for us to pass the peace. We know during these COVID times that we have tried to keep distancing, but today is Resurrection Sunday. So if you want to give someone a hug, give someone a hug. If you want to blow a kiss, blow a kiss. Let us pass the peace in the name of Jesus. Amen? Amen. Brothers and sisters, as you meander continue to pass the peace and return back to your seats. I did want to make one additional announcement. That in lieu of our service next Sunday, we will be streaming one of our pastor's homegoing services. So, now, and at this time, we'd like to have our children be dismissed for children's church. So as they are departing, we'd like to welcome back the Catherine Smith Contemporary Dance Ensemble. What a blessing to see young children making a joyful, I'm not going to say they're making a noise, they're making movements in the name of the Lord. Amen. One more hand clap of praise for these children of the Catherine Smith Contemporary Dance Ensemble. It's offering time, family. And today we are having two offerings. Our first is the normal tithes and offerings that we bring into the storehouse. Our second offering is a love offering for the Harden family. So you can do that the same way that we do our tithes and offerings. The Tithely app, PayPal, Cash App, or we'll take checks or cash. But in your Tithely, your Cash App, and your PayPal, just a note, love offering, in when it tells you where to do that. God loves a cheerful giver, and he allows us to keep 90% and only ask for 10%. And we ask that you, what you can give, no matter how much, it will be greatly appreciated for the building of his kingdom. Amen. Amen.
Begotten Son, the Son gave his life for me. When he died on Calvary, there's no greater love. Oh no. No greater love than a man would lay down his life for a friend, for a friend.
There is no
There's no greater love.
Ooh. No greater love.
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 Greater love. I know y'all know this song. Come on, sing with us.
That's love.
I don't hear you singing. Come on and sing with us.
Jesus went.
Yes, he did.
To Calvary.
Oh.
To save a wretch like you and me. That's love.
That's love.
That's love.
Oh, they hung him high and stretched him wide.
Sometimes, brothers and sisters, you gotta just step to the side and let the Spirit move. My body is tingling because the Spirit is just running through me right now. Okay. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the offerings that have been given today. We ask that you take these for the building of your kingdom and the uplifting of your community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So it's Women's History Month. And to celebrate, we have a young lady that's going to come up and give us a little education about a woman in history. Please welcome Miss Lonnie Jones.
Today I'm going to be sharing some information about the scientist named Clarice Phelps. Clarice Phelps, a nuclear chemist, was part of the research team responsible for the discovery of a new element, 117, also known as Tennessean. Was born in 1981 in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and reared in Edgewood housing projects in Nashville, Tennessee, by a single mother who also raised her three sisters. A violinist, Phelps began her interest in science early, including watching American educational children's television program, Brakeman's World, by the wacky scientist Beekman and his assistant Josiah, who answered viewers' STEM-related questions. When her mother saw her interest in natural sciences, she was given a microscope set retrieved from a garage sale and an encyclopedia-based science kit. Over time, Phelps began engaging in scientific research. In 2003, Phelps received a Bachelor of Science degree in chemistry from Tennessee State University at HBCU in Nashville, Tennessee. While there, she joined Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated. Graduating, Phelps enlisted in the United States Navy and eventually was assigned to maintain the chemistry and radiology controls on the aircraft carrier USS Ronald Reagan. The work earned her the Military Excellence Award. She was honorably discharged from the Navy in 2007. In 2009, Phelps began working with Oak Ridge National Laboratory in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, as a technician, and was later promoted to Research Associate and Program Manager. In 2013, Selenium-75, it was there that she discovered the new element, 117, which was named Tennessean. Phelps is the first African-American woman to help discover an element and the second black scientist in modern era after nuclear chemist James Andrew Harris. Discovery of the elements 104 and 105 in 1969. In 2017, Phelps received the Knoxville, Tennessee YWCA Tribute to Women Award in the category of Technology, Research, and Innovation. In 2019, Phelps was featured in the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry Periodic Table of Younger Chemists for her contribution to the research and the public engagement in 2021. Phelps earned a Master of Science degree in Mechanical Engineering from the University of Texas in Austin. She's a member of the American Chemical Society and currently pursuing the Doctor of Philosophy degree in Nuclear Engineering program at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. In addition, she continues to manage the industrial use of isotopes for the Isotopes and Fuel Cycle Technology Division at Oak Ridge and serves on its Educational Outreach Committee at Knox County Schools.
Thank you, Lonnie. If you would now, please stand for the reading of our scripture. The scripture comes to us from the New Testament, the 28th book of Matthew, verses 1 through 10. And following the reading of the scripture, after the praise team and the dance ensemble blesses us again, the next speaking voice you hear will be the minister of the hour, Dr. Sean Richmond. The scripture reads as follows. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and become as dead men. Verse 5 says, and the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. Verse 7, and go quickly and tell the disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, the goeth before you unto Galilee, there shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre, and fear and great joy, and did run to bring the disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. In verse 10, then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid, go tell my brethren that they go into the Galilee, and that shall be see, then thou shalt see me. This is the word of the Lord.
Jesus. I love the Lord. He heard my cry and he pitied every groan. Long as I live and troubles rise, I'll hasten to his throne. Am I alone with that testimony this morning? Am I the only one who has decided that even when troubles rise, I'll hasten to his throne this morning? Am I the only one? Am I in it all by myself when I say how much I love the Lord? He heard our cry. Oh, come on, church, stand to your feet. He's the Lord who hears our cries. He's the Lord who hears our cries. He's the Lord who hears our cries. And yet though our hearts are breaking, we will praise the Lord. Yet though our hearts are breaking, he's still God and he's still good. Yet though our hearts are breaking, we serve a risen Savior. Hallelujah. 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 Go ahead and praise him. Praise him if you feel it. Praise the God who raised him. Praise the God who for so loved us that he sent his only begotten son. Praise the God who loved us too much to leave us in it all by ourselves. He's a good God. He's a kind God. He's a merciful God. He's a God who can mend a broken heart. We know you'll do it, God. And we thank you this morning. We thank you, oh God, that hallelujah, he is risen. Amen. Amen. We give honor to God. We give honor to God. We thank him for his son, Jesus. We thank him for loving us so much that he did not leave us lost in sin. We thank you for loving him so much that he did not leave us without a comforter. He said, if it were not so, I would have told you. If you were in it by yourself, I would have told you. He said, I'm going to send a comforter for you, because there will come a time when you're going to need comforting, and I'm going to make sure you have that comfort when you need it. So if you can press through your tears, I promise to comfort you. I promise that there will be victory after this. I promise you that your weeping will only endure for a night, because joy, 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 joy is coming in the morning. And we thank him for it this morning. Last week we stood here and we received the heartbreaking news. Nothing about it has been easy. Nothing about this has been pleasant. Nothing about this has been something we'd wish on somebody else. However, we lament a loss of one who taught us, of one who prepared us, that a day will come when you're gonna press forward without me. And my job is to make sure you're ready. And we thank God for that life. We thank him for his teaching, and we thank him for his preaching. We thank him for his love, and we thank him for his guidance this morning. And we understand completely that he's still with us. In our hearts, he's still with us. He hadn't left us. We just can't look at his body anymore. He's in here right now, probably sending me text messages telling me, don't mess this thing up this morning. He's been a faithful servant, and we loved, and we will continue to love from now until forever, our beloved pastor, the Right Reverend Dr. Edward P. Harding Jr. To our ministers of music, God bless you. We thank God for your ministry, for those praise dancers. We thank God for each of them, and we thank them for the families who support them. We know that these dancers can't do that without mamas and daddies and aunties and grandmamas and those who get them back and forth to the practices and the rehearsals and buy the costumes and pay the fees. We know that each one of them represents a village of people who love them. Thank you for loving on those babies. We love them back, and we thank God for your support this morning. To our members, we stand in solidarity. We hold each other up. We lift each other up. I will not say that this too shall pass, but I will say I believe it gets better. I believe it gets better. To our family and friends from near and far in the building and online, God bless you. Thank you for standing with us during the most difficult season. We appreciate the outpouring of love on social media, email, text messages, phone calls. It's good to know when you're in it, that you're in it with people who know the power of prayer. We thank God for your prayers. I think we have lots of visitors. I see faces I don't recognize. I won't ask you to say anything, but could we ask visitors to stand? If this is your first time, second time, if you are a visitor from another place, I promise I won't make you say anything, but we would like to acknowledge you. Could the visitors just stand or wave a hand for us this morning? Look at this church. Look at this Church, look at this. We welcome you. We welcome you with the love of Christ. We welcome you in this house of Zion. If you are looking for a church home, it just so happens we got a few openings for members. If you're looking for a family to join, it just so happens our family has a couple more seats open at the table. You are welcome here. If you feel led to make this branch of Zion your home, please know you are welcome here. Thank you for visiting. Thank you for coming. One in particular is special. Many of you know that my commute here to the building is a long distance commute. And so for 3 years, I've commuted long distance. For 2.5 years from Shenandoah Valley. Y'all don't even know where that is, do you? On the other side of Dulles Airport. I commuted from Shenandoah Valley. I don't complain. It brings me great pleasure. I'm just glad to be in the house of the Lord. And then in October, I moved to Richmond. And when God moved me to Richmond, I was conflicted. Why would you move me there if the church is here? And I don't feel led to be someplace else. My heart is here. I feel led to serve here. I believe my gifts will make room for me here. So if that is the case, God, then why would you move me down to Richmond, Virginia, where my businesses are going to thrive? And I thank you for that. But my church home is here. And after from October through February and now March, driving up back and forth from Richmond, it was beginning to take its toll. Beginning to take its toll, I thought, well, maybe God's going to have me do a church home search. I called up Pastor Harding. I said, Pastor, I think I hear the Lord telling me that I'm going to find a new church home. He says, I think you heard wrong. So he says, go back into prayer and try that one again. And I began to try to figure out how to do the commute, to drive an hour and a half and serve and drive an hour and a half. And there's a whole life waiting there for me. So I went online to do a search. Some transportation searches. Uber Black was incredibly expensive, so that was not an option. I found some crazy website, I Drive You. Well, the way this works is they'll dispatch somebody to my house to pick me up in my car to drive me here. And I took a pass on that one. We won't do that. And then I found two driving services, and their numbers were through the roof. And for full transparency, there's just no budget for through the roof transportation services. So I just kept doing what Pastor said, keep going back to God, keep going back to God. And I became so frustrated, saints. I became frustrated. How is this going to work? And then the last inquiry that I'd made on the website, the gentleman texted me. I don't know if I responded right away. I might have waited. And he followed up. He followed up with email. He followed up with phone calls. And finally, we connected. And I said to the gentleman, so here's my situation. I'm here. My heart is there. And I'm trying to figure it out. He quotes a number. I said, let me say to you what I said to the others who quoted number, not even close. He says to me, well, we're doing the work of the Lord. And it just so happens I own a funeral home. And we have cars that are not always in use on Sundays. I can have one of my cars bring you to church and bring you back home. I ask, well, how does that work? Do you drop me off and go hang out at Starbucks and come back and pick me up? I'm new to all of this part, and come back and pick me up. How does he says, no, ma'am. When we drop you off, we stay and we participate in the service. And I said, well, I've got to run this by church leadership. There's protocol. I need to get permission. I need to get, it has to go through a vote. There's a whole, he says, I understand. And while you're working through that, let's get started and let's make sure you get to church. And so without a contract, just on our word, because he loves the Lord and he believes in what's happening, he's here today and he drove me this morning. Could you stand, Tripp? So when I was driving and got the phone call last, when I was riding and got the phone call last week, we thank God I wasn't driving. And in all of the planning this morning and the phone calls and the text messages and the service arrangements, I'm able to sit comfortably, quietly in a back seat and focus. And before bringing the word, I can pray and spend time with God before entering the building so that I enter with thanksgiving and praise, not rushed. And I thank God for making a way when we need a way made. He's a way making God, isn't he? For our worship leader, Brother Ken Jeffries, if he's tired this morning, that's because we've leaned on him all week long. His wife, where's his wife? Is she, ma'am, if you could excuse us with the late texts, late phone calls, emails, get up, come back, get on the meeting, sit down. We are so sorry we had to do that, but he answers every single time. He answers, and we thank God for you. We thank God for you. So that being said, I think I'm sure we have a word this morning from the Lord. We're praying for the loved ones of the devastating Francis Scott Key Bridge collapse this week. The Dalley is a 984-foot Singapore-flagged vessel. It reportedly lost power. It lost power while transitioning. It was moving from one place to the next place and lost power in the transition. It was transitioning from the Baltimore Harbor and it struck the bridge at about 1:27 a.m. Tuesday. The bridge, a nearly 2 mile long critical artery in East Coast shipping, crashed into the Patapsco River within seconds. No one on the ship was injured. Every construction worker, there were 8 fixing the potholes on the bridge when it collapsed. Of the 8, 2 of them survived. The others are presumed dead. We are praying for those families that God will comfort them because we too are familiar with loss. We understand what it means to lose and to have it hurt deeply when we lose. The details from the moments leading up to the devastating Francis Scott Key Bridge collapse were discovered on the cargo's black box. The black box records the communications between the pilot and the authorities when he was alerting them of an oncoming disaster. The black box audios reveal several alarms going off. Somebody say several. Several alarms going off. And then the pilot on duty, he made a radio call for assistance. So first the alarms go off, and then there's a call for help. Are you with me? The pilot said on the radio call that the Dalley had lost power. He says it lost power. It's nearing the bridge. I'm out of control. At the same time, an officer on duty for the Maryland Transportation Authority told officers who were at both ends of the bridge for road repairs, closed traffic, and it is believed that that call saved many more lives because many more people would have been on the bridge. As the powerless dolly was drifting 8 miles per hour, the black box recorded the sounds of the collision. 6 seconds later, the pilot reported to the Coast Guard that the bridge was down because the dolly lost power while it was in transition. If we could talk for a minute this morning, in Women's History Month on Resurrection Sunday, while processing the loss of our loved one, I thought we'd talk this morning about when the power goes out. When the power goes out. Gracious and kind God, we thank you for an opportunity to come together again in fellowship. We thank you for being the God of all, the God who's getting it right, the God who's trying to get it, those who's getting it right and those who are trying to get it right. Thank you for being the God who provides comfort. Thank you for being the God who provided the Son who came to save us. Thank you for being the God who left us with your word. Thank you for your word this morning. We pray now, O God, that you clear our minds and clear our hearts. If there's anything distracting us this morning, anything that keeps us from hearing from you and you alone this morning, would you cancel it, God? If our hearts are someplace else, if our minds are someplace else this morning, would you still us, comfort us, and focus us so that we don't miss one word from you? And Lord God, as you fill this place with your spirit, would you refresh your anointing on me? Would you lessen me so that all they see is you and all they hear is you this morning? Would you look at my heart, God, and let them know that everything that's flowing is flowing through me but from you? Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable, O God. You are our strength. You are our Redeemer. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. The New Testament provides the accounts of Jesus' ministry. And today's scriptures from Matthew give the details of the resurrection. And since we're concluding Women's History Month, by the way, dear, your presentation was perfect. It was perfect. We've had presentations throughout Women's History Month, and you brought it on home for us, and we thank you. We thank you for that. It was perfect. And thank you for the family who supports you while you do what you do. And since we're concluding Women's History Month and it's Resurrection Sunday, I thought we'd look at one of the women who was present during various events surrounding the crucifixion and the resurrection. There were many women there. The New Testament introduces us to 7 different Marys. Mary was a common name. In the Bible days, Mary was very common. It was as common as I was explaining to someone last night as Brenda's in my life. There are 5 Brenda's in my life. Isn't that something? 5 Brenda's. 2 walked me through my darkest days when my husband was transitioning. 1 is on a government contract that I manage, and we call her Mama Brenda. She makes us sit down and eat lunch together. One is the mother of a dear friend of mine, and everybody in our circle calls her Mama Brenda. And then the other, of course, is our beloved elder, Brenda Zanders. We love you. We recognize your tireless efforts. We recognize your heart. We recognize how diligently you pursue and fulfill the calling on your life. In many ways, you've served as a matriarch, the glue that holds a family together when they could be falling apart. Please know how much we appreciate you. And this is this Brenda. The other Brendas are special to me, but this Brenda holds a special place in the heart of Prince George's Community Church. And we do love you. So the seven Marys, then how do we know which Mary we're speaking of at any given time? There are two ways the Bible distinguishes in the New Testament between the Marys. Three of the Marys are referred to by family lineage, Mary the mother of. So if the Mary had children, we would know which Mary was being spoken of by who her children were. Mary the virgin mother, we get that, the Mary of Jesus, the mother of Jesus Christ. Mary the mother of James is in the New Testament. Mary the mother of John Mark is in the New Testament. Well, what about the Marys who were without children? They would be distinguished by geography. Mary of Bethany. Mary of Bethany, we know her. She was Martha's sister, Lazarus' sister. We know which Mary's being referred to when they talk about the one who prepared the meals for Jesus to make sure he always ate, because the Bible specifies it was Mary of Bethany. There's Mary of Clopas, there's Mary of Rome. And then today's key figure from the scripture, there's Mary of Magdala. Mary of Magdala. Now, I often wonder where my grandparents got it from. Now, we're deep down Southern folk. Gettysburg, I know you never heard of it. I was born in Gettysburg. Now, a thing would happen when a girl became of age in Gettysburg and began to date. Her family would ask a question. Want to know the question that Southern folk ask a young girl when she's beginning to date? Who are his people? Everybody understands what it means when a grandmama, a mama, or a daddy asks, and who are his people? See, who are his people gives them some insight to his background, to his upbringing. Because if he did not come from good people, then a good girl could not date him. We probably wanted to, but a good girl could not date the bad boy from bad people. That's another whole sermon all in itself. And so in asking who are his people, that would give the family some insights as to what was being brought into the life, so that then they could decide that they approved or disapproved depending on his people. So for Mary Magdala, the question is, who are her people? What's going on in Magdala that made Mary Magdalene? That's where we get the word Magdalene, because she's of Magdala. It's an adjective, Magdalene, describing where she came from. What is it about Magdala and the people of Magdala that meet approval? What is it about the people of Magdala that distinguishes this Mary from the other Marys? What do we know about Magdala? Magdala was an ancient Jewish city, so we know that she was Jewish. It was on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. That tells us a lot, too. We'll come back to the Sea of Galilee, but this is helping us get some background information on Mary Magdala. Now, her story is significant for three reasons. The first is she was faithfully devoted to Jesus. Mary Magdalene is described as one of the most devoted followers of Jesus Christ in the entire New Testament. The second significance is her witness. She stayed with him through the crucifixion when it became so unbearable that others could not do it. It became so painful to watch that others could not do it. There were those who had to turn their heads away when he was being crucified. There were those who could not stomach seeing his feet nailed to a cross. There were those who could not bear the image of nails through his hand. There were those who says, I cannot take it anymore. When he was crowned with thorns, when he was pierced in his side, there were those who says, I just can't do this. When he cried out for thirst and they fed him vinegar, but Mary Magdalene stayed right there. Mary Magdalene was the first person to witness Jesus on that resurrection morning. She was the first one to see him on that resurrection morning. She became the messenger to go tell the disciples he had risen. What is it about Mary Magdalene that made her so faithfully devoted even when others could not? What was it about Mary Magdalene that he allowed her to be the first person to see him and then made her the first post-resurrection evangelist? Go give the good news. You go, Mary, and proclaim the good news that I now have victory over death. What was it about Mary Magdalene? She's mentioned by name 12 times in the canonical Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. 12 times they're talking about Mary Magdalene. She's mentioned more in the New Testament than any of the apostles, Mary Magdalene. More than any other woman in the Bible, Mary Magdalene is mentioned. What is it about Mary Magdalene? What made her not just devoted, but the most devoted? What made her the first witness to witness Christ after the resurrection? What was it about Mary? Why did he choose her to be the first to proclaim his victory? Where is Mary's testimony? The four Gospels give us fragments of her story, and they talk about Mary a lot. We know that she was healed by Jesus because Mark tells us in 16 and 9, and Luke tells us in 8, 2, and 3. Where is her testimony? She had followed Jesus from Galilee. She had endured crucifixion. She was faithful even unto his death. We know that because Mark tells us in chapter 26. Matthew tells us in chapter 26 and 7, Mark in chapter 15, and John in chapter 19. They have lots to tell us about Mary. Where are her notes? She was at his tomb. It was a big deal that she stayed at the tomb when others could not or would not. Matthew chapters 27 and 28 says she was at his tomb. Mark chapters 15 and 16, she was at his tomb. Luke chapters 23 and 24, she was at his tomb. John chapter 20, she was at his tomb. Why can't we hear from Mary? Why can't Mary tell her own story? She had ministered to Christ of her own substance. Luke 8 and 3, she wasn't in it for the money. She was using her own resources. She was a woman of means from the Sea of Galilee, the most prominent fishing town. A Jew from the most prominent fishing town means Mary came from means. She had her own money to support herself and the ministry. Why can't we hear her tell it for herself? It is undeniable. It is without question that Mary Magdalene was delivered from demons by Jesus. Wouldn't it be great to hear her tell her story? Thank you, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, for sharing the parts of it that you did. Thank you, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, for introducing us to Mary Magdalene. But I received a text message from one of my aunties, you know, the ones that boss everybody around. I have a few of those in my life now telling me everything that I need to be doing. She's watching. Love you, auntie. And so she says to me, the one that I'm talking about, she texts me this week, and you know, the auntie who does a head roll, and they say it like they're saying it with love, but really they're bossing you around. And I have one this week, and she says to me, whatever you do, don't lose your voice. You speak for yourself. Do you hear me, Niecy? I said, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I hear you. And I wish she could have said that to Mary Magdalene. Where is your voice? Why are these brothers, and we thank them for their story, but why are they speaking for you? If you're the most devoted, why can't you speak for yourself, Mary Magdalene? If you love Christ so much, why can't you speak it for yourself, Mary Magdalene? I need to know why you are next to Mary, the mother of Jesus, the most prominent woman in the New Testament, and I have to read about it through somebody else's story. Magdala was a fishing town. It was the same hometown as Peter and Andrew. They were fishermen just like her family was. Sounds lateral to me. That tells us who her people are, that she came from the well-to-dos. Her people would not have been those of struggle. Her stories are prevalent, but fragmented. We get glimpses of her story through the eyes of four other people. Why do we not have her own account of what happened between her and Christ at the crucifixion and at the tomb on Resurrection Sunday morning? Three potential reasons. The first one I'm not so much in agreement with, but it has been supposed that, well, it could be because she was a woman. Could have been. On any other day, I might agree, because all of the books of the Bible were written by men, with one possible exception. The book of Hebrews, often referred to as the fifth gospel, when you look in your Bibles, it says author unknown, but there's strong reason to believe that Priscilla wrote the book of Hebrews. Okay. Ruth has her own book in the Bible, but she did not write it. Samuel wrote the book of Ruth. It's been called the most beautiful story ever written, and it's Ruth's story, but Samuel wrote it. I'll take it. It's still a good book, Ruth. Esther has her own book. She teaches us the power of prayer. Wonderful, isn't it? But she did not write it. Mordecai wrote the book of Esther. Took it upon himself to tell us how the sister could pray. I would have taken that from Mary Magdalene. Instead of bits and pieces of her story, could she have had her own book? She was there when Jesus was preaching. She was there when he was teaching. She was there when he was praying. She was there when he was performing miracles. She was there when he was betrayed. And she stayed with him. She was there at the Last Supper. She was there at the crucifixion. She was there at the resurrection. And yet we read fragments of her story. Well, here's the thing, church. She actually did write a book. It's called The Gospel According to Mary. She wrote a book. It was not included with the other gospels. She wrote a book, but when the Romans were canonizing the books for the Bible, when they were making decisions on what would or would not be included, The decision was made unanimously that Mary's book was unorthodox. Still God inspired, still God breathed, and still her story and her words, but it was not deemed conventional enough to be included in the Bible. Oh, she wrote a book. She wrote 250 pages in her book. How do I know? Because I went digging deep to find it. It was excluded from the canon, but she wrote it and she entitled it The Gospel According to Mary. It's non-canonical, meaning it's not included as part of the Bible. However, it's authenticity has been verified. Mary. It was discovered in 1896. Now, as a publisher, you know how much I love books. You know how much I love books. I needed to know, what did it look like? What form did it take? Do you all know Mary Magdalene had a full manuscript? She used papyrus, where we get paper, the original paper, went down to Egypt and got papyrus. It's 250 pages of handwritten, it's been preserved, inked on papyrus manuscript in the words of Mary. It's bound in codex. What does that mean? The binding of a book. So this wasn't the scrolls rolled up. She wrote, organized, bound, and published her own book. Yes, she did, Mary Magdalene. Now, what language was the book in? Because we need to know this. It was written in what's called Sahidic Coptic. Why is this important? Because this was an ancient Egyptian language for the elite. She was educated. She was well educated, and it was written in the Greek alphabet. So, Reverend Anderson, while I'm still struggling with Greek, I'm in the fight with Greek, and right now I'm not winning. Reverend Anderson, y'all pray for me. My final exam is the fourth week of April. I'm a fast and pray because I'm not doing well. But she wrote it using the Greek alphabet, 250 pages in an ancient Egyptian language. Now we know some stuff about Mary Magdalene. She was wealthy. She was educated. And she was multilingual, Mary Magdalene. So now the Gospel of Mary, it was purchased in Cairo, Egypt, where she sent her manuscript down to be preserved. It did not matter to her that her book was not included with the others. You see, her book was a personal testimony between her and her Lord. She didn't need accolades for her writing. She didn't need it to be published and put out on Amazon. She knew what she knew, that she had had an encounter with Christ, and when she had it, he changed her forever. So the fragments were published in two parts. It appears that she had a bound manuscript and notes. They were published in 1938. They were translated in 1955. And so that still leaves us the question, why was it deemed unorthodox? What was it about this book that made everyone so uncomfortable? Part one of the book has a different tone from part two of the book. In part one, it's kind of funny to read. She describes Peter as hot-tempered. We know that. She says that Peter was the spokesperson for the group. Okay. She says Peter was very vocal about opposing her being included with the disciples because she's a woman. And so when we read of Mary Magdalene, that's why we read the disciples and Mary Magdalene. The disciples were there and Mary Magdalene. Can you imagine a society full of people who worship without a title? Can you imagine people so devoted to Christ that even when they're on the outskirts, even when they are the misfit, even when they are not welcomed and included, they stand right there and they stay with Christ anyway. Can you imagine the heart of a person who's serving him without getting paid, without title, without accolades, and in the face of constant opposition? Now I'm curious, Mary, what made you so devoted? Why didn't you say, if these 12 men don't want me here, I can go serve someplace else? Why didn't you say, Mary, if I got to spend my own money and sleep in a tent by myself because the men are over there, I'll just go home to my well-to-do family? There's something here interesting about Mary Magdalene, isn't it? She writes that Andrew, Peter's brother, it was funny to read this part, he likes her enough, but she's strange. So now she's unorthodox and strange. Is Mary weird? What's happening with Mary here, and what is strange about her? In part one of her book, Levi appears on the scene. Levi defends her. When Peter is rebuking her, Levi defends her. Leave her alone. She's a little peculiar. She's not like the rest of us, but her heart is good. And this is when grandmamas say, bless her heart, bless her heart. So Mary is unorthodox. Mary's teaching style is strange. Mary is a misfit in the group, and now Mary needs defending. Let's come back to the canon. In the Bible, Mary is mentioned as the one from whom Jesus cast seven demons. We get that in Luke 8 and 2 and Mark 16 and 19. In her book, she describes the demons. When she describes them, the literal translation, Reverend Denise, it's Greek, it's the literal translation is not the word demon, it's power. She says, and I'm going to quote Mary Magdalene from her book, there are seven powers within me, and they're having conversations with my soul. Legion means a large group. It means many. She describes a legion of demons at war inside of her with her soul. Would you like to know what those seven powers are? Mary Magdalene describes the first one as darkness. The translation is depression. She says, there's the one power that was in me, was past tense, because we know she's going to be delivered. There's the one power that seeks to keep me in darkness. It's a sadness that I cannot break through. There's this one power who is determined no matter what to keep me in darkness and depressed. If I beat that power, it comes back with more powers. If I can beat depression, it comes back with more demons. What are they? And the second one is desire. What desire says, you can use intimacy and substances to help you combat the depression. The third one is ignorance. Ignorance says if you don't learn better, you'll never do better. You'll stay stuck forever. The fourth power, as Mary's describing it in her own words, was a thrill seeker. Go out and have a great time, and maybe you can outrun depression. Maybe you can have such a good time that you can forget you're depressed. That was the fourth power. The fifth power was material possessions. You're in it, and you're in the darkness, but if you can buy a few more things, I don't know, name brand, designer stuff, just keep buying stuff. Even when you can't afford it, eventually it'll make you feel better about yourself. You're depressed, but your shoes are cute. You're in darkness, but man, that's a nice car. That power wants you to believe, church. It wants you to believe that you can buy enough stuff and have enough stuff that you will forget about the darkness, about the sins of the flesh with intimacy and substances, that you'll forget about false prophecy. The sixth power, she called it the power of foolish wisdom. It convinces you that you're smarter than everybody else. I don't need help because I've got it figured out. I don't need a counselor because I know me better than they do. I don't need a lawyer. I can draw up my own documents. I don't need to go to Bible study. I can pick it up and read it when I'm ready. That one power convinces us that we know so much, we can't learn anything from anybody. Not teachable, not learnable, not getting. Church, isn't it scripture in all that getting? Get understanding. The final power, she said, was the power she described as obstacles and negative influence. She'd be on her way to the meeting for the prayer. Something would happen and she could not go. You know, Tripp, she's on her way to church and the tire goes flat. You know, Brother Carter, she's on her way to church and the car gets sideswiped. You all know what I'm talking about. You go to sign on for Bible study and the internet goes down. You know, that's the one I'm talking about. You done prayed for those children all night long and some knucklehead at the school gets to say something that influences them. She's describing it. All of this is going on inside of Mary Magdalene. All seven of these powers are inside of her, controlling her. They're at war inside of her. Darkness, desire, ignorance, thrill, material possession, foolishness, and obstacle. If you ever decide to look it up, it's in the Gospel of Mary, chapter 8. Something else interesting happens in her book, and I think this may be why they deemed it unorthodox. She never calls Jesus by his name. It could be that the Romans took issue with her never calling him by name. So what was it she called him? The Savior. The Savior said, the Savior did, the Savior taught. She recognized him as the Savior because when he cast all of the demons out of her and forbid them to come back, he saved her from them. He saved her. And she never forgot the one who saved her. When she was alone in the darkness, he saved her. When she was struggling with sin, he saved her. When she was being taught false prophecy, he saved her. When she had been convincing herself that material wealth would fix her, he saved her. When she was out at night doing things that she should not have been doing, trying to make herself feel better, he saved her. When the disciples would not receive her and she was alone in the group, the outcast, he saved her. When they said she was strange, she was peculiar, she didn't teach like the other folk taught, he saved her. She spends all of her books saying, the Savior, he saved me. When she saw that he was saving others and he was preaching and teaching and delivering others, she found him. The Bible says she put herself in his pathway so that when he was healing and delivering, oh, she wanted to meet him. She described him. She says she heard he was kind and gentle. She had heard he was performing miracles. She had heard he was teaching about deliverance. And then she says, and she heard he had been delivering people from powers. My interpretation, Brother Raymond, of the translation of her writings is when she heard he was passing through. When she heard he was passing through. And she finally got herself in front of him. Church, she says, pass me not. Oh, gentle Savior, would you hear my humble cry. And while on all the others you are calling, do not pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. That was the tone of part one. And he heard her, and he answered her, and he delivered her. So when you get to part two of the Gospel of Mary, her tone has changed. She's not desperate anymore because she's been delivered. You see, you're only desperate when you're in it. Once you've been delivered, you move from desperate to devoted. She says, I'll devote my life to the one who saved me. I don't care what they say. I'll leave my family. I'll spend my own money. I'll drive as many miles as I have to drive if my Savior says so. I'll feed them out of my own pocket. I can pay Peter and Andrew, no, never mind, because I know what I know, and that is the Savior saved me. I don't need validation. I don't need a co-signer. I know what I know. Send my book down there and plant them with the history books. If nobody reads it, it's fine by me, because this was between me and the Savior. So when she gets to part two of the book, her tone changes. The desperation is gone. Her joy is back. She's got some footing now. When she gets to part two, she said, he's sweet. I know. He's sweet. I know. Storm clouds may rise. Strong winds may blow. I'll tell the world wherever I go. I found a Savior, and he's sweet. I know. He's sweet. I know. Even if Peter doesn't know it, he's sweet. I know. If nobody hears my testimony, he's sweet. I know. If my name's not in the history books, he's sweet. I know, because he moved me from desperate to delivered. And I thank the Savior for my deliverance. So what happened? Saints, what happened when the dally lost power? And it was powerless. There was no one to drive it. It was left without power. So it coasted into destruction. I've got some good news this morning. He did not leave us without power. It's not his intent for us to coast into destruction. When their power went out, they did not have a source. But this morning, we have a source. We have a power that never goes out. We have a power that's sustainable. We have a power. Don't you know what that power is on this Resurrection Sunday? It's the blood. The blood that Jesus shed for me way back, way back, way back on Calvary. It's the blood that gives me strength from day to day, and it will never, never, never lose its power. The songwriter says it reaches to the highest mountain. It flows, it flows, it flows through the lowest valley. It soothes my doubt, and it calms my fears, and it dries all my tears. The blood that gives me strength from day to day will never, never lose its power.
To the highest, never lose its power.
It will never ever lose.
Never lose its power.
Hallelujah. It will never, ever, never,
ever,
never, ever, never, ever
lose.
No, it won't. No, it won't. No, it won't. No, no, no.
Lose its
power. No, it won't. No, it won't. No matter what happens, it won't lose.
Never lose its power.
Hallelujah. Never ever lose.
Never lose its power. Never lose its power.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, God, for blood that will never lose its power. Thank you, God, that the power will never go out. Thank you, God, that we won't cruise into destruction. Thank you, God, that you have a plan for us, and that plan is hope and for a future. Thank you, God, for a power that comforts us. Thank you, God, for a power that can drive out all the other powers. Thank you, God, this morning for the blood that will never, never lose its power. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. At this point in the service, we would extend an invitation. I trust that you all will not take this lightly. When we extend the invitation, what we're saying is you could today be powerless. If you have no power today, we invite you to tap into the power source. In this house of Zion, we invite you to tap into the power source that can drive out all the other powers. You don't have to fight those demons by yourself. We've got a power who's declaimed on Resurrection Sunday, "I rise with all power in my hand." Would you stand to your feet? If you are without a church home, we welcome you in this place. If you are without a church home, if you have a church home, but you've been away for a while, beginning in June, we're going to have new members classes. We're going to have rededication classes. We invite you to get back in touch. We invite you to tap back into the power source. Do not leave here without power today. We will teach with you. We will pray with you. We will love with you. When your heart is aching, we will share in the sorrow with you. When you're joyful, we will rejoice with you. You are welcome at the Prince George's Community Church. In the blood.
Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
Would there be one? If you're contemplating, if you're thinking about it, and you're not sure today's your day, I caution you to not think too long. And when it is your day, hallelujah. We've got time. If there's one who feels led to be a part of what God's doing in this house, we've got time. What does it mean when an invitation is extended? It means you think maybe you're okay, but you're not sure. It means you may have never confessed with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. It means that maybe you were baptized, maybe you weren't, you're not sure. We want you to be sure. We want you to know that you know that you know that Jesus Christ has saved you. And that he is in you, filling you with his Holy Spirit. We want you to know that in this house, you become family and will love you and will train you and will work with you. And we will make room for you as your gifts make room for you here. If God has gifted you, your gift is welcome here. The gift of prayer, the gift of prophecy, the gift of laying on of hands, the gift of comfort. If there's a ministry in you, it's welcome here. There is power. And we're inviting you an opportunity to tap into that power source.
Morning, church. We have a candidate for a membership, London Alexis Downing, who was christened in this church over 20 years ago. But today she stands on her own to say that she has accepted God as her personal Savior. That she no longer requires the covering of her family that we have given her. And I take a special pride in accepting her because she's my granddaughter.
Amen. Amen. Even amidst our sorrow, beautiful things are happening. From the wonder-working power, even in our sorrow, we have joy this morning. And we thank you. God bless you, Sister London. She's been in Bible study on Thursday nights asking questions about salvation and baptism. She had questions. She's been joining us on the Monday noon devotions. And when she says, I think that I know, but I'm not sure that I know, this morning Sister London says, now I know that I know. And we praise God for you, baby. If hearts and minds are clear, we'll pray. Lord God, we thank you for loving us so much that you sent your only begotten Son. We thank you, oh God, that he lived and he loved. We thank you, oh God, that he suffered the cross just for us. We thank you, oh God, that he endured the grave just for us. And Lord God, we thank you that the story does not end there. We thank you, oh God, that on that early resurrection morning, when the stone was rolled away, we thank you, oh God, that you allowed us to learn that he had risen just as he said he would. thank you, oh God, that he not just rose, but he rose with all power. And we thank you, oh God, that that power shall never, ever lose. Thank you, oh God, that that's a power that never, ever goes out. Thank you, oh God, that that's a power that keeps us from destruction. We love you this morning, Lord. We love you. And we thank you, God, for loving us. It is in the mighty, matchless, majestic name of our risen Lord and Savior we say, amen. Amen. And those who are able to stand for our benediction, if you could stretch your hands forward and repeat after me. And now unto God, who had his son shed blood just for me, who shed blood that will never, never, never lose its power. I go from this place knowing that Jesus Christ is my risen Savior. I go in peace. I go in love. I go in power. In Jesus' name, amen. Hug somebody.